In order to make friends with the editor, there are a few simple tasks we need to master. We'll need to know how to open a file. We'll need to know how to navigate. By that I mean move the cursor around, page up, page down. We'd like to give a command to the editor. At some point, we'll want to close our editor, and we'll have choices then. Do we want to save the file we've been working with, or do we want to quit? Also, we want to be able to search. We want to get help. And we may even want to do something like find the line number of some text in the file. So let's take a look at how we can do that. To open the file, as before, we're going to type edit and the name of a file. And I made a file to help explain the keyboard that we'll want to make friends with. And this is called editor keys.txt. Depending on your keyboard and your terminal emulation program, the keys may be mapped differently. On a typical 101 key keyboard, there's a numeric keypad that all of us are familiar with. It's got the 0 through 9 keys and an enter key on it. We'll call this the numeric keypad over here. In between the numeric keypad and the rest of the keyboard are 6 keys that may be labeled find and select and insert and so on, or they could be labeled according to the PC world, insert, home, delete, and so on. We'll call this the edit keypad. The edit keypad also includes 4 cursor keys for moving up, down, left, and right. One of the things that you'll want to learn is how your keyboard is mapped. So if you press the key here in this position on your keyboard, it might be labeled insert. If you get text message like I have here, nothing to insert, then your keyboard is probably not mapped exactly the way the VT terminals were. So let's take a look at the next screen full of information here. And that is this little picture. Many of the newer terminal emulation programs, for example Reflection, work in the Windows world, and they map the keyboard for the convenience of a PC user. So here we find that the find function is the home key. So if I press home and I get a prompt forward find, then it confirms for me that my keyboard is mapped in this manner. This is probably the way your keyboard works. To quit the find function, we just hit the return key and it'll say nothing to find, no big deal. Okay, so one of the things to realize is the keyboard may work differently when you're typing on the VMS system than you're used to its behavior when you're working on PC-based applications. An important key to find will be the do key or command key. For most of us, the editor will map this to the PF4 key. The PF keys are the keys running across the top of your numeric keypad. So PF1 is numlock, PF2 is the slash, PF3 is the asterisk or star key, and PF4 is the minus sign. If you press the minus sign on your numeric keypad, you should get a prompt here like this that says command. And again, if you hit return, that'll do nothing. Let's quit this file so we don't make changes to it. Let's say I accidentally made a mistake and I don't want to save it. So I can press the command key and type in the word quit. And that'll take me back out to the command prompt of VMS. If I want to, I can open the file again. In some cases, you're going to be editing a file, and you'll know ahead of time that you don't really want to save changes to the file. You just want to look at the file. But you want to be able to use the powerful features of the editor to search the text, perhaps copy text, and paste it into another file, and some of the other functions you can perform. So you can use edit/no output, as I have here, and that'll open the file in read-only mode. At this point, then, if I type PF4, which is the command key, and I type the word exit, which is normally how you would save a file and exit the editor, it exits without making changes. Let's continue working with the editor. This time I'm going to return to the sample.txt file that we used a moment ago. To open the file, I'm going to type edit sample.txt, and I can tell from this buffer prompt here that I'm probably in the TPU editor. Okay, so one of the things we'll want to do, is again reviewing, is you can use the up and down arrow keys that are just below the edit keypad to navigate throughout the file. When you're in the TPU editor, generally the cursor doesn't wrap around from the left end of the line to the previous line. That's a feature of the editor. You can also use the page down key to advance in the file, and the page up key or previous page key to go back toward the top of the file. You can press the PF4 key to give a command to the editor. PF4 can also be called the do key. When you press the do key or the command key, you get a prompt like this here. And at this point, we can type write to save our file if we've made changes to it. Write is something important to remember. With this editor, it turns out that the editor is customizable, and the save command causes the editor to become recompiled. So you don't want to use save, you want to type the word write. When you write the file out, either because you're closing and exiting the file or because you use the write command, you get a prompt down here at the bottom of the screen that says how many lines are written to the file, and you get the new file name, including the version number here, so the file version should be incrementing. To close the editor, we can type the command key and type in the word exit, or there's a shortcut for that. The shortcut is the Control-Z keystroke sequence. So sitting anywhere in the editor like this, if I press Control-Z, that closes and saves the file. Notice I didn't get a message about how many lines were written and a new file name. The editor detects whether or not the file has been changed since the last save. If the file has been changed, it writes it out. If it hasn't been changed, it just exits the editor. Returning to edit sample.txt again, let's say that I've made a bunch of changes to the file. And for whatever reason, I decide, I'm not sure I want to do that. I want to quit. Again, press the command key or do key and type in the word quit. I have to spell it out. You'll be prompted to continue quitting, yes. And the warning here is to warn you that any changes you made won't be saved. So if I type yes here, or just hit the return key, it will abort the edit. My changes will not be saved, and I'll return to the command line. If I work with a sample.txt file again, I can use the find function, that's probably the home key on your PC keyboard, to look for text. So I can, for instance, look for the word file, and if I press the home key again, and then on this prompt here press the home key again, that'll find the next occurrence of the file, the word file. Okay. When you've gotten to the end of the file, or when it has searched the end of the file and there are no more finds, then it asks you if you want to search backwards. So in this case it's prompted me to go reverse, so I'll say yes, and it'll find the next find, and if I press home twice again it finds the next find. And then it says, I've got to the beginning of the file, haven't found anything, do you want to go forward? If I say yes, then it'll find the next occurrence of the word file. I can press the command key and I can get help for functions if I'm interested. So for instance, I can type help, select, and that'll give me help on the select command. Once I have opened up this help buffer, I can scroll down or up in the file using my page up and page down keys, and when I'm ready I just hit return on an empty input, and that takes me back to the file I was editing. Okay. One of the things that I can do in the file is I can press command or do and type in a line number such as 40. Oh, I got to type in line 40. And the system will take me to that location in the file. Turns out that 40 is beyond the end of the file, so it takes me to the end of the file. Okay. So to recall that command, line 40 will take you to that location in the file. Since I've got this open, what I just did is I pressed the command key, PF4, and then I up arrowed, and so the last some commands I've typed in are in a command buffer, just like at the command line. So if you're performing a similar task over and over and over again, you can use the up and down arrow keys to step through your command buffer. I'm going to quit the file, and when we come back with our next lesson, we're going to take a look at some common text editing procedures such as copying and cutting and pasting text. I suppose up to now our work with the editor could have been called Editing 101. At this point we're going to start Editing 201. In this section we're going to take a look at some more advanced functions such as marking and blocking text, copying and pasting it, inserting it. We'll also take a look in another lesson at having multiple files open at once and managing buffers. To start, let's go back to the sample.txt file we've been playing with. Let's say I want to pick up this text and move it to the end of the file. So I put my cursor at the beginning of where I would like to start either marking a block of text or removing a block of text, and I press the select key. If you're typing on a newer version of Reflection, that's probably the end key on your edit keypad. At this point, I've got a prompt down here at the bottom of the screen that says move the text cursor to select text. So what I can do is use my up and down arrow keys to select the text that I want. If I don't want the whole line, I can use the right and left arrow keys to select as much of the line as I want. Okay. When I've got the text selected that I want to work with, I can then press the delete key or the remove key on my keypad, and that yanks the text out and puts it into a special buffer. So that's what the remove does. And now I can go down to the end of the file and I can paste that text back in by pressing the insert key. If I want to insert the text back from where it originally came from, so I'd have now two copies of the text in the file, I can come back here and press the insert key again. Typically, when you want to copy a range of text, rather than cut it, move down, paste, move back up, paste, what you would do is something like this. Press the end key to select, use the cursor key to select the range of text, press delete, insert, and then go down to wherever you want to do your paste and press the insert key again. Okay? And you can press the insert key as many times as you want to, and that'll keep inserting the text. So we've just seen marking a block of text, removing it, pasting it, and then used combinations of remove and paste to cut and paste text. Continuing with some more advanced editor functions, let's take a look at this sample.txt file again. By now you're pretty familiar with what this editor screen looks like. One of the things that you can do with this editor screen is have multiple windows or multiple buffers active at the same time. In the simplest case, I can have one file but looking at two different parts of it at the same time. To open up more than one window, you put your cursor someplace in the file, and anywhere will do, press the command key and type in the word two. That splits the screen into two sections, and we see then we've got two status lines here, both telling us we're working with a buffer called sample.txt. And now I can have the top part of the screen look at the beginning of the file, and since my cursor is active in the bottom part of the screen, I can press the page down, page down, page down key to look at the end of the file. So I've got two different parts of the same file open at once. If I want to, I could type on this file here and add in a tag name, and then I could decide that I want to toggle to the other window to see what's up there. To toggle to the other window, you press the command key and type in the word other. Now you can cursor around and work on this part of the file. So to go back and forth, you just press the command key and type in the word other, and it steps to the next buffer. This is pretty simple because I've got the same file open twice. But what happens if I open up two files, each in a different window? Start out the same way. You open the first file, and then you press the command key and type in the word two, and then you press the command key and you type get file, whatever the next file name will be. So what if I take a look at that editor keys.txt file we were looking at a few minutes ago? So now I load that into the second buffer. So I can be looking at one file and editing on the other, and then when I want to toggle to the opposite file, I type the word other, and then here I can be working on this file, inserting or removing text as I like, and then press the command key, other, to toggle back to the second file and so on. It's possible to have more than two windows going at once. However, the space on the screen is sort of limited, so having more than two windows open at once probably isn't very useful. But there's nothing to prevent me from typing the word two and splitting the second window in half, and then typing the word two and splitting the third window in half, and so on. As you can see, these windows get pretty small, so they're probably not very useful. When you're done with all this, you can just type one, and that creates one window with the buffer that was selected at the time you did that active on the screen. Before I finish with the editor, I wanted to show you something. In the previous lesson, we had several screen sections open at once, and we had two different files open at once. Each of the files caused a buffer to be created. You can see what buffers are currently active in the editor by pressing the command key and typing show buffer. So here we can see that I've got two buffers. There's 38 lines in one, 75 in the other, and one of the buffers is highlighted. We can see editor keys.txt. That's the buffer that's currently active. If you have several buffers open, or even just two buffers as I have here, you can put your cursor on a different buffer and press the select key to load that buffer into memory and work with it. So you don't have to have the screen split to use this feature. You can just use the command key and the show buffer command to toggle between the buffers. Again, that was show buffer. And then you use your cursor key to move up and down through the list. In this case, I just have two items, so I just move to the next item and press select, and that loads the alternate buffer. If you've been making changes in more than one buffer, when you exit the editor, it asks you if you want to save your changes. In my case, I haven't made any changes here, so it didn't ask me. But when you type exit or control Z in a multiple buffer session, it saves the current active buffer and then checks for changes in the others and prompts you for saving each of the others. That's it for editing.